May the peace of peace be upon you. May the peace of peace, which has no inside and no outside, be upon that which has no inside or outside. And we start out in the mood of repentance, which is to admit that I have a severe continuity problem, which is why you're working on it. We have a severe continuity problem, but that's the only problem we have. So in working on this, we're spending our time in the only valuable ways possible, which is to work on this continuity problem. Can we make a deal with the ego? Does the ego have a deal to offer us? Well, since the ego cannot offer us a deal at all, and let's look at this, because the ego, all it can do, it's fixed, it's a projection, doesn't have any free will. Its only goal is to annihilate its maker, and its goal is fixed. It cannot deviate from that. That's the only place it can see its own safety from threat. So what deal can it offer us? It can't change its goal. The only deal that the ego can offer us is a delay in reaching the goal. The ego will say, okay, well, I won't reach that goal today, but I'll reach it tomorrow. They'll give you one more day, give you one more life. That's the only goal the ego has, is to offer you this delay. It never changes its fixed goal, which is to annihilate its maker. And since ego is a projection that feels it's a separate self, but it feels threatened by a projection, and since its maker is the one projecting it, it feels that to destroy its maker is to save it from annihilation. And it cannot reach any other conclusion other than that. So the ego, it can't compromise. It's only offering us delay. That's it. Now it will disguise this, of course, but we have to see through the disguise. The ego only offers us death and destruction. That's it. And it just, all the structuring of what's called a deal, there is no deal. It's just delay. So if we see that everything is here just delay, not a deal, that changes our perspective, doesn't it? And we won't be tempted to slack, because most people think that they're slacking. Why? Because they're making a deal. They're saying, well, no, I'm making a really great deal. There is no deal with the ego. The ego is in no position to make a deal, because it's just a projection. It's not God. It can't do anything to change the circumstances, its circumstances, at all. It has no deal to offer us. So this is very important to look at this. I think it's March 15th, which means just a day or two left to really shake off the dust of the ego's madness. So we keep looking at the ego's madness here. Gathering our will. Not letting our will get carried away by anything, no matter how beautiful it may seem. We are gathering our will to look at the madness of the ego, so we realize it is madness and that it doesn't have a deal for us. It's very important. As long as we think the ego has a deal for us, we won't employ what's truly effective to enter into the vision of oneness, because we'll be too busy trying to work on this deal. Therein lies our problem. We say, well, I need to make a deal, so I need to give and take. The ego's gonna give and take. I need to give and take. So what the ego has asked me is to at least make a good faith gesture and don't use that doubling down form of spiritual practice, right? Where may the bliss of bliss, which is the bliss that has neither inside nor outside, be upon that which has neither inside nor outside. This is a powerful, effective form of entering into the vision of oneness. The ego says, look, just don't do that. Okay, it's a good faith, that's the terms to enter into negotiations. The ego says, look, you need, in a negotiation, you have to trust each side. There's good faith in negotiating. So in order to establish this trust to negotiate, you need to at least drop that form of practice, because it's the most effective form of practice, for sure. And so that's why we don't do it, because we feel that's necessary to at least have dialogue with the ego. Because if we use that form of practice, the ego stops all dialogue with us. Why? Because it has gone silent. It has nothing to say, which is what we want. So you may wonder, why is this practice not used in the world? I've never heard this practice used. It's because of this. We're making one gesture to show good faith to the ego that we're willing to compromise. All right, the ego says, hey, I'm willing to compromise, you got to show me willingness. Well, what is the ego compromising in? Let's first, what is its good faith gesture? Here's the question. The question is, can the ego compromise? Or is there such a thing as compromise? Is there some compromise between truth and lies? Is some other condition that is something not one or the other? How is that possible? Is there some compromise between reality and unreality, illusions? Is there something, how's that possible? So the ego, where's its good faith? Has it come off its demand that we die? No, it hasn't. Where's its good faith? It hasn't. But the ego says, you know, you need to start the process by giving up effective practice. And the ego says, if you do this effective practice, then the ego will not negotiate. No, that's a lie. What happens is the ego will go to sleep, because the projection is ending when you do this. You're ending your projections. The ego claims that it's merely waiting for you to enter into good faith negotiations. No, it's not. It's going to sleep. You're putting it to sleep. You're ending the ego, the delusion of this projection. You're ending the belief in inside and outside, in subject, object, object, as far as identity goes. When we talk about all spiritual practices, we're really talking about identity. Okay. Of course, from a functional standpoint, we know that this thing, form-wise, is not inside this other thing, form-wise, and that, as far as just spatial arrangements go, as far as walking and whatever. But what we're talking about here is identity. We're always talking about, what is our identity? What is our true nature? Is what we are perceiving, is that our true identity, or is that a false misperception of our identity? It's a misperception. So what we're trying to do, what we're doing, is healing perception. So the doubling down takes the ego out of the negotiation mode. But the ego is not negotiating. All the ego is negotiating is delay. This is what we need to realize, that the ego's good faith is to say, well, I won't annihilate you right now, but we'll negotiate the terms of your annihilation. So I won't do it right now, that's my good faith. I'll do it a little later, but we'll negotiate when it happens. Not if it happens, but when. That's the only negotiation that the ego is negotiating on. That's the only issue. It will pretend, verbiage-wise, to be entertaining all sorts of stuff, but it always never can let go of this intense focused desire that its maker be annihilated. So it thinks that will save it. It's after its salvation. Okay, keep that in mind. We're after our salvation. The eagle's after its salvation. And, you know, just as we have a fixed goal, the ego has a fixed goal. So there is really no negotiation taking place. Let's be honest. There's never been. There's never been. We've just been deceiving ourselves, thinking so. But it's only been delay. It's all that's been taking place from the beginning of this ridiculous, whimsical notion of trying to be prime creator is delay. Just delay. Nothing else. That's why Jesus says all we've done has been wandering about idly, time idly spent. Just delay. Meanwhile, we keep thinking we're negotiating some great settlement. No. The great settlement is not so much a settlement, but a reminder of reality. The vision of oneness is the reminder of reality. It reminds us of reality flawlessly. And that solves the continuity problem. The only problem we have is the continuity problem. We don't have a negotiation problem. We can say, I don't have a negotiation problem. I have a continuity problem. I don't have a delay problem. I have a continuity problem. I don't have a delay problem. I have a continuity problem. Now, how should spiritual willingness, if there's some willingness from someone, how should that be used? For me, it has to be used to establish the basics, which is the mood of repentance and the continuity problem is my only problem, and practice those. So use the willingness to spiritual will to gain facility. So that's absolutely drilled into the mind, and it's like basic technique, like playing a piano. Where you can always fall back on the basics when you're trying to do something fancy, and you may say, you know, you may want to, it's difficult, I'm getting a little tired, my focus, my will is getting tired, then you just fall back on the basics, and the playing is seamless and it continues. That's the secret. The secret of the great musicians is that the basics are so completely ingrained in them that they never fear going for something even something very beautiful and trying all sorts of stuff, because they know the basics are there. They don't have to search for the basics. Always at hand. That is the secret. I taught piano in a previous life. I taught piano, and I told my students that you have to sweat the basics. What happened was the students would come with all this eager desire because they heard me play so well, and they said, wow, I want to play like that. That is like beautiful. And that's fancy, all this fancy stuff. Wow. And so teach me how to do this fancy stuff. And I said, look, in order to do that fancy stuff, you have to be an expert at all the basics. And this is true. And nobody got that. You know, they didn't get it. They didn't get, therein lies the problem on the spiritual path, on any path. It's the foundation, it's the basics. So all that fancy stuff, I could put my focus on that for a while. Quickly, quick little, you know, quick stuff, and I do this really embellishments. Because I knew that all the basics were there. And there wouldn't be any continuity problem should the train of inspiration drop out, which it does, of course, in any musical playing. Train of inspiration drops out at some point. Sure it does. But the underlying basics could always be relied upon and were there to fall back upon. To keep it all going, to keep it all smooth, to keep it all, you know, all together, it all hangs together. Exactly, it's exactly the same in spiritual practice, is the basics are always there. So you can make this big push into looking at the ego, but at the same time, always be able to fall back on, I have a severe continuity problem. I don't have a denial problem. I have a continuity problem. Or whatever, looking at the ego, you suddenly realize, whoa, you know, there's just a kind of a problem here. You see, you can say, I don't have this problem, I have a continuity problem. And get right back centered. It centers you. You have to have a way to be effortlessly centered. Otherwise, it'll seem, the spiritual practice will seem too difficult. Too difficult. But our very situation we're in pushes us into trying to make the dramatic, you know, flourish instead of the basics. Now the dramatic flourish will be there once you master the basics, for sure. Then you'll be able to remove these blocks, you know, and be able to continue to abide in the humbleness of the mood of repentance, saying, I have a severe continuity problem. I don't have a deal problem. So you fall back on this. Once you make this big push, and the ego is trying to engage you in instability, you don't engage there. You say, you go back to the basics and say, I have a severe continuity problem. It's the only problem I have. I do not have a deal problem. I do not have a deal problem. I have a continuity problem. The deal problem has zero value to me. Only the vision of oneness has value to me. This is the basic technique that you fall back on. You don't allow the ego to aggrandize you, because the ego will say, wow, you got it. Isn't that incredible? How did you get that? It will try to aggrandize you, and then the wheels start coming off. No, you go back into your humility. Okay, you always fall back into your mood of humility on the spiritual path. This is the basic. There are basic techniques on the spiritual path that you have to master, meaning they're always there. It's just like playing a piano or a guitar or some musical instrument. You know the basic chords, the basic progressions, where you can play them on the neck or on the piano. And if you're going up higher in the piano, da 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 da, you know the chords down here are always there. You know, you can always go back to those basic fill stuff, right? And smooth out the fancy stuff that you're doing. And if you have that in your mind, then you can seem to be very improvisational, right? And you can go in any direction, and people will say, wow, how incredible. But it's not incredible. It's because you put in the hard work to always have the basics there. And you continually know that you don't get caught up in aggrandizement or instability. You always smooth it back out into the basic humility. That's the secret. So really, the highest form of art is the spiritual path, is spiritual practice. It's higher than music. It's higher than music, it's higher than dance, it's higher than painting, it's higher than any other art form. It is the highest art form, actually. But those, the basics of the other art forms can be transferred over to the spiritual path. That's what I did. I took the discipline of music and then transferred it into the higher art form, which is spiritual practice, and gradually accepted that you have to have these basics here. Okay, you have to have those. Otherwise, you're not going to be able to reach the heights that you want to, that you need to. You need to be able to remove the blocks to the awareness of the vision of oneness. And you need to make these forays into these blocks and say, ah, okay, I can see that the ego has no deal for me. You know, this is very profound recognition. But upon that, you need to start out with the humility, and you need to end with the humility, and you need to be able to smooth it back into this humility, the vision, confession of continuity problem. The successful ones are the ones that realize this and do the tough work. You know, it doesn't take that long. I mean, you might spend like a month or two really pushing it, or maybe even less than that, several weeks or a month or two, however long. So it's ingrained in you. You have to ingrain this in yourself. So when you start feeling like you're getting uncentered, You go back to the center and say, I have a continuity problem. If you're able to do this stuff that seems to be very difficult, and you'll have the confidence that you can do it. You'll have the confidence. It takes confidence to look at this stuff. It really does. The confidence is born of your humility, your humbleness, saying, I do have incredibly severe continuity problem. Only the vision of oneness resolves this continuity problem for me. So I'm working to align all my valuing with vision of oneness, because we know that valuing is perception. We only perceive what we value. It's very true. It's amazing in life as you go through, and you may notice something. I've been living in the same place my entire life, virtually my entire life. Let us say, for the last, 54 or 5 years or something. Same place, same place, same place, same place. And I'm driving along and I see something and say, I never saw that before. I've never even been here. There's this area of town, small town. I've never even driven here before. How's that possible? Our valuing directs our attention. It directs our attention. So the oneness is here. It's not anywhere else but here. It's everywhere, rather. The oneness is everywhere. It's omnipresent. But we don't see it because we don't value it. That's all it is. We do not value it. We are valuing a deal with the ego more than the vision of oneness. Let's just be honest about that. And again, if you're getting like, whoa, it's too much. You say, well, I don't have a valuing problem. I have a continuity problem. You center back into that. I don't have a deal problem. I have a continuity problem. That's how you escape. If the ego is starting to overwhelm you with its tricks, you retreat back into that basic confession of what we're here for. I have a severe continuity problem. Only the vision of oneness resolves the continuity problem. And then you can go back and you can look at valuing and how it controls your perception. But ultimately, the continuity problem is the problem. Okay, it's not a valuing problem we have, it's the continuity problem. Okay, that is the real problem we have, is that we're afraid to let go of this deal with the ego. We're valuing the deal, you see, is what we're saying. So we don't have a valuing the deal problem. I don't have a valuing the deal problem. I have a continuity problem. That's the problem I have. So all alignment of valuing needs to be on the vision of oneness. To solve my real problem, which is the continuity problem, I don't have a deal problem. We're valuing a deal more than the vision of oneness. That's it. It's plain and simple. There isn't any other real dynamic at work at its root. It's simply because we're valuing making a deal with the ego, we've agreed not to look upon everywhereness, not to look upon the oneness, the vision of oneness. And it's just a simple agreement. And the power of decision is within me. In other words, the power of agreement is within me. I have the power of agreement. The power of agreement is within me. What I value, I will look upon. I've agreed not to look upon the vision of oneness. So this is where we need to get to. And to confess, I have agreed not to look upon it, for the sake of entering into negotiations with the ego for a deal. See? And now we think that if we can get the ego to move off its demand for our eternal death, then we'll be able to become prime creator, because we won't have this trouble with the ego. So we're still trying to... Well, at this point, let us say that the continuity problem is the only real problem we have. And we think we need to make a deal with the ego to solve our continuity problem. Because we say, the ego, can you please, not, you know, make life so terrible for us, so we won't feel like giving it up. That's what we're saying. Let's look at it that way. Yeah. Okay. Ego. That, okay, now we're getting into the good humor part, which means we're getting close, really close. Because it's funny. We've agreed not to look upon the vision of oneness. Okay. Because we're negotiating from the fear of the continuity problem, we're thinking the ego has to do something. Because we're not aware of the vision of oneness. See, our negotiations have come from the standpoint of we don't want to give up our dream, because we think we'd be catapulted back into reality, and we don't have any clue what reality's like anymore. So we're too scared of that. So we want to keep the dream, but we want to keep everything we're familiar with. And how do we do that? By feeling a little better about it, because it's really so terrible, this dream, that we want to dump it. We really want to dump it. So when we realize that the ego is putting all this suffering on us, and its demand for our death, you know, is causing us in our aging, the demand we identify with bodies, all this stuff, we say, ego, your demands are just so tough on us. Could you at least, you know, ease these demands on us so that we don't feel like we're going to just drop all this? You know, can you, and that, because that causes us fear. So the ego seems to be the answer to lessening our fear of the continuity problem. Okay, it seems to be. But we're unaware of the Holy Spirit. Now, the Holy Spirit actually does have a way to cure our continuity fear, which is a vision of oneness. But our focus has been on negotiating with the ego for so long. And what we need to realize is the ego doesn't have any deal for us. It doesn't have any way to actually lessen its demands. It only has delay. Now, is a delay lessening of demands or not? It's not. It's not. It's not really. What the ego will do is say, well, I won't make my full demands upon you right now. So you have a grace period. But you're still entirely under the spell of the ego, thinking that it is a separate will. And the demands haven't changed at all. It's just saying that you have a little time to figure out how to meet these demands. That's all the ego's saying. You're still dying. You're still aging. You're still feeling vulnerable. You're still feeling there's a separate will that's more powerful than you. The ego's demands that you commit a spiritual suicide are still exactly the same. The ego's just saying that you have a little time to get ready to accept all these demands. So this is the little crumb that the ego gives us. The ego gives us really nothing except just a little tiny worthless crumb of kind of saying, well, I won't hang you this morning, I'll hang you this afternoon. I'll give you a little more time to say your prayers before I hang you. That's all the ego's doing. And at some point, you just have to say, you know, forget it. I'm not, you know, there's no deal here really for me. I'm going to look somewhere else. And the ego says, whoa, okay, I'll hang you this evening. You know, this evening. I'll give you a few more prayers before I hang you. I say, that's the same. I don't want to be hung. You know, I don't want to die. So, no deal. Forget it. I'm through trying to make a deal with you. And then immediately the Holy Spirit, you become aware of some ally you have. Like, whoa, I have some other option. There's some other option I have. What is that option? Then you start thinking, what is that option? And then you're so used to making deals with the ego, then you start trying to make deals with this option. And what the Holy Spirit tells you is this option is the deal that God has given you. It's a deal with God, meaning you don't have to immediately accept reality. That you can have that kind of holy delay, meaning you can go through a remembrance of reality before you are totally aware of reality and functioning with this total knowing again. So God does meet us halfway with this vision of oneness, knowing we have a continuity problem. Because God can't change reality at all. Just as the ego can't change its demand for us, God cannot change its demand for us, which is reality is real. There is no other reality. There is no other oneness. There is no other everywhereness. There's only one reality. There's not two. That cannot change. But what God can do is say, you don't have to know this immediately. You can perceive this. You can have this vision. Vision is still a type of perception. It's a subtle perception. So you can have this sort of visual, the subtle perception of oneness, but it's still not knowing of oneness. So it's still delaying the knowing of it, but it's a delay that gets rid of delay. Whereas the ego's delay doesn't get rid of delay, because the ego's goal can never be reached. So basically, when you're negotiating with the ego, you're basically putting yourself into an endless waiting game, an endless delay game, where you're continuously experiencing death of form, loss you're continually experiencing this device that is making you believe. Well, let's put it this way: you're continuously experiencing this relentless pressure that is trying to convince you to commit spiritual suicide. That's actually what you're experiencing. This whole nature, body, all of this construct is designed to pressure spirit into committing spiritual suicide. In other words, eternal death, annihilation. So you just continue to experience that. That's all. And the ego thinks that you make new deals. Well, you know, you won't commit spiritual suicide yet, but just a little later you will. You're just given a little grace time. See, don't you know? I don't want the total pressure, because I don't really want to do it. Well, guess what? You can't do it. You can't commit spiritual suicide. So the ego really has nothing to offer us. No deal at all. Whereas God can offer us a deal. Because this quote-unquote delay, the vision of oneness, is the delay that ends all delay. Whereas the ego's situation, it doesn't end delay, because you cannot reach its goal. Whereas in God, you can reach its goal. The goal of knowing reality is reachable, whereas the goal of spiritual suicide is not reachable. You see, there's a difference between the ego's deal and the Holy Spirit's deal, right? The ego has no deal for you, because the goal can't be reached. It's just endless delay, endless extreme pressure from the ego. The whole situation here is designed to pressure us. It is a pressure system. It is a pressure cooker, actually. This existence, as we are seeing it, okay, is a pressure cooker designed to get us to commit spiritual suicide. That's the ego's goal for us, so that the ego feels that it won't die, because its maker, which projected it, is gone. But since the ego's a projection, it would vanish too. But the ego feels that when spirit dies eternally, that in that instant, the projection ends, and the ego thinks that it's free of projection and is a new self now. So the ego believes in this magical belief that when spirit is eternally annihilated, the projection ends. And if the projection ends, that means it's a separate free will now. See, it's no longer a projection. It's been born again, resurrected from the, it'll be resurrected from the dead as a free of all projection. The ego will be a separate will and be prime creator. This is just completely magical belief, totally magical belief. So There you have it. Now we go back to, I have a severe continuity problem. I don't have a magical belief problem. I have a continuity problem. Continuity problem is the only problem that I have. The vision of oneness is the only remedy there is for the continuity problem. Only the vision of oneness has value. This is this great centering that doesn't let the ego work with your ambivalence. When you look into these issues and you see it, for a while you'll be a little like, oh my gosh, oh my gosh, oh my gosh. Just go right back into the continuity confession of humility. I have a severe continuity problem. I don't have any other problem. This is the only problem that I have. It's the only problem that I have. I have no other problem. The magical belief problem has zero value to me, has no value to me as a problem, right? See, I don't try to solve the problem at the level of the magical belief problem. I don't work with the magical belief problem to make a deal with that or to solve that problem. No, I work on the vision of oneness, to enter into the vision of oneness, because I work on the continuity problem. What I see is this magical problem is not really a problem for me, because the vision of oneness will solve it, see? So it's not really a problem. It's a problem I've assumed I had, you know, this problem with the ego, all this stuff. But really, I realize it's ridiculous. There's really no issue there that's holding me back. Only the continuity problem is holding me back from actual, true happiness. Because this ego's position is just ridiculous. So how can it be a problem? It's not a problem, it's totally ridiculous. But then you say, well, wait a minute, I still feel I have a problem. That's when you immediately go back and say, yes, I have a severe continuity problem. Otherwise, you'll think that you do have a problem with the ego, because you're feeling some problem. So then you start engaging with the ego, thinking, well, I must still have a problem with the ego. No, we don't have any problem with the ego. The ego's position is totally ridiculous. Therefore, it's not a problem. It's only to be laughed at. It's not a problem to laugh at it. That is true. But we do have a continuity problem. So this is the issue. If we don't recognize we have a continuity problem, we will then assume it's coming from somewhere else, and then enter into negotiations with the somewhere else, which would be the ego's construct. And then we get totally off track and lost, and our spiritual practice just falls apart on us. And we feel like we're just not getting anywhere, and we're right back in the clutches of the ego, begging the ego to lessen our problems, so, you know, all this kind of stuff. Now, the vision of oneness will lessen our problems, okay? Not the ego. The vision of oneness is now, the past belongs to the Holy Spirit. See, let the Holy Spirit will deal with whatever constructs there are that we've made in terms of any issue, any functioning that needs to take place there. Our goal, our only responsibility is the vision of oneness. The Holy Spirit's responsibility is the past. Okay, that's part of its responsibility, is simply to deal with everything, the world, everything, nature, all that stuff. As far as, well, what's going to happen to it. The Holy Spirit, it's in the hands of the Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit is totally benevolent, totally wise, totally benevolent. And so it's not our problem at all. It won't forget to laugh. You see, the last laugh comes from the Holy Spirit. Okay, so just give the Holy Spirit the last laugh. All right, we'll laugh now. The Holy Spirit, put the past in the Holy Spirit's hands. It will have the last laugh, and it will simply laugh it away. That's all. How does all this end? With the laughter of the Holy Spirit is how it all ends, actually. The final, we wonder, well, how does this universe, how does it come to an end? What is it? The Holy Spirit will simply have a final laugh. and that will be the end of it. That's how it ends. So let the Holy Spirit. We'll laugh now and say, yes, okay, Holy Spirit. We'll laugh as we hand it over to the Holy Spirit and say, it's nothing. It's just completely silly. Ridiculous. Totally ridiculous. And now that we have the vision of oneness, and the Holy Spirit will have the last laugh, the final laugh, all right? Simple. That's how it goes. Have any problem except the continuity problem. Hand over the world to the Holy Spirit and it will only laugh. It will not take it seriously. I guarantee you, as Jesus has guaranteed me, that the Holy Spirit will not take it seriously. If you hand it over to the Holy Spirit, it will not take it seriously at the end. It won't say, oh my gosh, no, this is serious. We need to reconstrue all this. And no, it will not take it seriously. It will have a final laugh. And that is it. So if we can accept this, then we'll be able to make this exchange. Exchange all of this for the vision of oneness. All this ridiculousness. Now, the vision of oneness is serious in that it is reminding us of reality. So that is important. That is serious. Trying to commit spiritual suicide is not serious, it's ridiculous. Totally ridiculous. The Holy Spirit will not believe it's possible. The Holy Spirit knows it's not possible, so it will just laugh it away and that's it. So we don't have to tell the Holy Spirit that it's not possible. We just have to affirm that we know that this is so and the Holy Spirit knows it's so. But what we really need is a vision of oneness. So this doubling down, I'm seeing it's very powerful, very, very powerful technique. Because the ego seems to just, doesn't seem to be there anymore in your mental construct. Some people use silence. They try to go enter into silence. But I think that, at least in our modern world, we're so verbally, conceptually, label-oriented, location and label, it helps to use words. And, but by using words and doubling down, may the vision of vision be upon the vision that is neither within you nor without you. Nor outside of you, neither inside of you nor outside of you. You see, the ego feels that you've stopped trying to make any deal with it. It cannot relate to what you're saying at all. It feels you've stopped, and you feel you've stopped. So it's like a way of practicing the full stop that we need, the full stop. That's a non-dual term that some use, the full stop. Yes, you need to practice it. And trying to practice it just like being quiet. Okay, I'm just going to be real quiet. Some can do that. And we can do it too. But normally we're in a sort of a verbal mode here in our modern society, which is so hustle and bustle, right? So our practicing, it can easily be just doubling down on these words. Say with things, may this stone of this stone, be the vision of neither inside nor outside. stone of this stone be the vision of the vision that is neither outside nor inside. May the plant of this plant be the plant that is neither inside nor outside. You can say that too. May this table of this table be this table that is neither inside table nor outside table. This puts us into a different state of receptivity, doesn't it? You see, we have expectations based on location, label, and thought and all this. By practicing this different way of structuring expectations and location and label, then the vision of oneness can dawn upon us. And we say, oh, that meets my expectations of location, label, yeah. This is the table that is this table, that is this table that is neither the inside table nor the outside table. It is the shared identity table. I welcome the shared identity table. I welcome the shared identity plant. I welcome the shared identity stone. I welcome the shared identity sky. I welcome the shared identity tree. I welcome the shared identity driveway. I welcome the shared identity car. I welcome the shared identity space. I welcome the shared identity breath. I welcome the shared identity life. I welcome the shared identity tree. Now, the problem we have is we're thinking that we're sharing an identity with some other thing, like person. Well, yeah, me and you, we have a shared identity. No, we're welcoming the shared identity with everything. It's not like we're forming a group, crystallizing it with some group, because this group is the one identity, but the other stuff isn't. So you cannot exclude anything or anyone or at all when you're practicing. You cannot say, well, this is a special relationship here, forming a special identity. No, it's the one shared identity. This is what gives it the kick that we need. This is what gives it this wonderful feeling that gives us the remembrance of reality. Only this. There is no special identity. There is no special exclusion at all. There is no inside. There is no outside at all. There isn't like something that has some inside to it, so yeah, or some outside to it. There isn't some person you say, well, everything else has no inside or outside, but you have an inside and an outside. Therefore, I'm in a subject-object relationship with you. There is no subject-object relationship as far as identity goes in the vision of oneness. Jesus does say that something about two minds needing to accept this. You can use the mind of Jesus or the mind of some other teacher, or you can use the mind of the Holy Spirit to be the mind that you're accepting it with too. It doesn't have to be another person in your life. It doesn't have to be. That's why sages can realize this in a cave or something. The mind is actually one. But the practice is this. Oh, have to go back to the continuity problem. I have a severe continuity problem and recenter. Because this is actually a very advanced practice. And stay in humility. So I've momentarily just sort of forgotten the practice because it is actually such extremely different than we're used to, right, in our normal conceptual patterns. So don't struggle. When you forget it, go right back into the continuity issue. I have a severe continuity problem. I don't have to make a deal with the ego problem. I have a continuity problem. To make a deal with the ego problem has zero value. Only the vision of oneness has value. Only the vision of oneness has value. May this table without an inside, that is the table without an outside. Be the one shared identity that is neither inside nor outside. So when we practice different conceptual expectations, the tendency is to fall back into the old expectations, and you forget, I don't know how to practice again. Go back to the continuity problem, the humility of that, and center yourself in that. So you stay smooth. You see, you don't see the wheels coming off of me just because I couldn't remember it. I said, that's fine, it's no problem. You don't break your gait, you know, you stay steady. You stay steady, you keep on walking. As we used to say, keep on trucking. You know, just keep on trucking here. 60s slang. Whatever happens, just keep on trucking. But the way to do it is you have to go back into confession of humility. I have a severe continuity problem here. Severe continuity problem. And so I'm okay with the fact that this advanced practice seemed to slip away for a moment. I remember I talked about piano, you do some really super nice embellishment, and then you may think, well, how did I do that? And you start thinking, I can't remember how I did that. And you go back to the basics then. Because I can't quite remember, what did I just say? I know it was profound, but it's okay. I just have a severe continuity problem. Of course I'm going to forget it. I have a severe continuity problem. May the peace of peace that is neither within the peace that is peace or outside the peace that is peace, may that be upon the self which is neither, has neither inside nor outside. May that be upon us which is free of all insideness and all outsideness. May this table of this table, which is free of all insideness and outsideness, be the one shared identity of that which is free of all outsideness and all insideness. So like in practice sessions, like with the piano, you practice trying to work on, you know, really, really great, cool stuff. It's important if you stumble a little bit, you just keep on playing right back into the basics, and you keep your confidence going like that. You don't stop and say, oh, I can't get it. What did I do wrong? No, you can't do that. Practice has to have this seamlessness to it. Confidence has to remain. May the freedom of freedom be upon you. May the spaced outness be upon you. May the zero dimensionality of zero dimensionality be upon you. May the unbounded freedom of unbounded freedom be upon you. May that stone, which is the stone of neither inside stone nor outside stone, be the stone of the stone. May that plant, which is neither the inside plant nor the outside plant, be the plant of that plant. May the barbecue, which is neither the inside barbecue nor the outside barbecue, be the barbecue of that barbecue. May that post, which is neither the inside post nor the outside post, be the post of that post. May that planter, which is neither the inside planter nor the outside planter, be the planter of that, be the eternal planter of that eternal planter. May that dirt, which is neither the inside of that dirt nor the outside of that dirt, be the eternal dirt of that eternal dirt. May that tree, which is neither the inside tree nor the outside tree, be the eternal tree of that eternal tree. May that car, which is neither the inside of car nor the outside car, be the eternal car of that car. May that road, which is neither the inside of that road nor the outside of that road, be that eternal road, which is that eternal road. And you can say, which is that eternal road, 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 which is that eternal road. You can go on like that. Some of the spiritual practices use that repetition, where they just keep doing it continuously, and that is an actual technique that is used, has been used in various places. So you would say, may that road, which is neither the inside road or the outside road, be that road, which is that eternal 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 road, which is that. And you can go into a meditation that takes that on. May that road, I have a severe continuity problem here, and I know that I don't have a deal with the ego problem. I have a continuity problem. Continuity problem is the only problem that I have. The vision of oneness is the only remedy for the continuity, severe continuity problem I have. Therefore, the deal with the ego problem has zero value to me. Only the vision of oneness has value for me. Only the vision of oneness has value for me. So may that tree, which is not that inside tree nor that outside tree, be the eternal tree of that tree. May this desk, which is neither the inside desk nor the outside desk, be the one eternal desk that is the one eternal desk. because neither the inside day nor the outside day be the eternal day that is the eternal day that is the eternal day that is the eternal day. And I don't have a practice problem, I have a continuity problem. The continuity problem is the only problem that I have. The practice problem has no value, only the vision of oneness has value. So we're rearranging our conceptual mental construct expectations so that the vision of oneness fits right, fits there. And we say, it fits my expectations. Expectations. See, that's all. We're just getting our expectations so vision of oneness just fits. And we just say, oh, that's easy. And sure, it just fits what I expected. This is what I expected. This is what I expected. All right. I'm getting a little chilled here. It's early morning. It should be a nice day today, so I'm sure I'll do some taping later. And this has been a very fruitful taping. So we will end this video now. That's it.